Dear viewer, you are welcome. We are back again to continue this, our exposition on occult maladies and false prophets. We are now on occult maladies and false prophets, part 5. Once again, let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you. You say that we shall know the truth, and the truth will set us free. And when you stood before Pilate and asked him what you told him this is, he asked what is the truth. He now turned his back and went his way, as many of us turn our back today upon the truth. Father, grant that the viewer of this message will not turn his back to the truth. Grant also that the viewer of this message will not be subjugated or subdued by the illusions of these occult maladies and false prophets, that your freedom and light will flourish. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Occult maladies and false prophets, part 5. We are going to read the book of Psalms. I want to read Psalms chapter 7. Psalms chapter 7 is where we are taking our test for this moment. Give me a moment. Let's bring that Bible verse. Psalm 7, verse 14 says, "Behold, he travelled with iniquity, and had conceived mischief, and brought forth falsehood." I read it again. "Behold, he travelled with iniquity, and had conceived mischief, and brought forth falsehood." This is the state of the false prophets and the promoters of occult maladies. They have nothing to offer you than mischief, than iniquity, and falsehood. And you fall into this trap, you fall into their network, when you fail to appreciate the genuine power of the Almighty God that sent into this world through Christ. When you understand the fundamental basis of the operational mechanisms of the Holy Spirit, and when you live within the essence of that understanding, these things we are talking about here will look so childish and so illusory that you will even not imagine any human being involved in them. You see, but human beings are involved in these things. Just like in the former exposition, part 4 that came up before this part 5, we mentioned about an Adonai, a being, you know, somewhere. You know, and has deceived a lot of people all over the world. Yet, when this being made contact with the Habitat of the Last God, he was asking for help. He's tired. We are going to publish because he's in the process. He's undergoing, you know, having given his life to Christ now. He is going to bring about his own testimony. We'll make sure that it comes up on different platforms in our world. And that Adonai, you know, even while doing all these things, and people consider him to be a great, some people is a great occult man, some people is a great prophet and all this, because of the way he organized that environment and the so-called, some beings speak from the ground. Not just human beings, some boys, no, that's underground. You just make this place under it. But people don't know, they think it's a spirit speaking. But himself as a human being, doesn't even remember his dream. He told me, he said it by himself. He doesn't remember his dream. Cannot even recollect any dream. Yeah? And most of the night, according to him, he was always having nightmares. But physically now, he comes around there and the people go there, politicians. They go there, pay a lot of money, because people like deceit. Have you not read in the scriptures, even when our Lord Jesus Christ was on earth? And they say that Pilate was asking the people, the Jews, the religious officials say, "Who do you want me to release? Was it Barnabas or Jesus? What do you You see how that they demanded for the release of Barnabas. That is human beings for you. They always try to subjugate truth, but truth can never be subjugated. And I am making this exposition to set someone free somewhere. If you're under the illusion of these maladies and false prophets, that you'll be set free. Because these things are so much in our world. So much. They are there in the church. They are there in the mosque. They are there in the temples. They are there in the ashrams. They are there in the Bethels. They are there in different places. They are in places where they are not supposed to be found. They are also there. You see? But what we seek for is the power of the Almighty Father, the genuine power of the Almighty Father. That is everywhere at all times. And sometimes when you hear this, I have been warning. I say, don't condemn organization. Don't look at these false prophets and occult malady in the light of organization. Because if you look at it in the light of organization only, then when an organization does not conform to the system of your belief system, you condemn that entire organization and you give approval to a particular organization. That this organization, yeah, this is a born again organization. This is a Pentecostal organization. I warn you, seek the Spirit of God only. Because even in that Pentecost, the so-called Pentecostal organization that in your belief system is a holy place, if you don't take it and force with this, it's thriving there. If you watch well by the Spirit of God, you see falsehood there. You see? You may see an organization and you see genuine servants of God there. Don't say because there are genuine servants of God there that the entire organization, you know, how is they are all purified and everybody there, that no false prophet. No. Some false prophets can be there. You see, I remember something that happened. That this is in a prominent, in a leading Pentecostal church in Nigeria, and this Pentecostal church is so structured that it exists in different nations of the world. It's not even founded in Nigeria, but in Nigeria you have the name of that Pentecostal church registered, like so and so. If the name is so and so church Nigeria, you also have the same that denomination, so and so church. That's their name, Ghana. You still have so and so church America. So all over the world, it's a leading Pentecostal church. And to some people, it is believed that such organization can never give birth to false prophets because the preaching there is against false prophets. Yes, that is true. I agree to some extent that the organization in its own essence shouldn't bring forth a false prophet. But that does not rule out the false prophets from being there by the spirit that they have. These false prophets and these occult maladies and all this, they will even pass through the framework of that system to bring out, they use the framework to manifest their own falsehood. There was a woman in that kind of a Pentecostal church who was able, through her manipulations, she was able to, you know, establish herself as an authority in a particular district headquarters of that Pentecostal church somewhere in Nigeria, to the extent that it is not believed by the hierarchy of the church that the Spirit of God is using this woman, not knowing that the woman has her own network, well established network of people that are even paid, that are given allowances to work within that network. You see, some of these networks, they say they are going from crusade, from here to here. It extends from one church system to other church system. Some of these things are just, they try to fake the real thing. They fake it, it looks real. You see, somebody says he's going for a crusade. And when he's come to that crusade, he will sit down in one place. I will call the phone numbers of some people. It will tell you that there's somebody, his name is Theophilus here, and that this is his phone number, and that this is the cloth he's wearing. If the person is here, I should come out. When the person comes out, the congregation, everybody. That day, there will be a big offering. Money. You see? Now, something is involved there. If the person does that by the Spirit of the Lord, so the Spirit of the Lord reveal all those things to him, that's a different matter. But I'm also saying that there are people that fake it. They send their own network. As the man is going to crusade in Enugu in Nigeria, some members of the network will come from Kaduna, come from Lokoja, come from? It's a network. You see, unemployment in our world has created a lot of things. That is, the quest to survive. The quest to survive by men, young women. This woman established herself as an authority. To the extent that sometimes even the law of the church were stepped down by the words spoken by this woman. For instance, there was a time that the head of that, the district pastor there, a man of God, you know, who has the spirit of God, the man was trying to doubt the way this woman is operating. But before the man could say it out, he said it to some members, some confidential member that they were trying to cast make investigation about it. They told the man that this woman is being led by God. Not the man didn't know, the district pastor of the church didn't know that even some of these people that represent leaders of the church that discussed some of these things, that they were in the network of the woman. So they now reversed and used the network of the woman. The woman has to come to the church on Sunday, because each time service is going on Sunday, that's a designated time. When that time comes, you see the woman will rise and begin to shake herself. And you know, when all those kind of activities are done, people believe that when things are done like that, that's when Holy Ghost is at work. Don't have all these phantasmagories in your thinking. They are deceitful. I am warning you, if you want, you take my warning. If you don't want, because if you want to serve the Lord, you have to know the truth. You have to understand the mysteries of existence. You have to understand yourself. You have to see yourself established as a citizen of the universe. This will fear nothing. All these things will become childish. But if you put yourself within the bondage of religion, you can be manipulated. I'm telling you. So you see, I used to tell people that religion is made to be a heaven, a resting place for the souls of the sons of men, or the daughters of men. But in our time, religion has turned out to become, even of old unto this day, doctrines and dogmas of religion have turned out to become a prison yard. So many people are in prison now in the name of religion. Everybody remain calm and silent. And the woman took advantage of all these things. She herself doesn't even know anything. Even these are people who cannot even remember their dreams. Or see, even if a fly is flying across their face in the spirit, they can't even see it. But they are promoted to be champions and in the midst of congregations and religious men. You see. But when the woman stands up, she moves around. Anything she says is final. Because before that time, they allow her to possess that authority. Because she has said certain things that happened in their own terms in that way. Many people will not like to tell you all these things we are telling you now. I'm telling you the truth, that you have to, if you are seeking for gold, like I said in part four, you must try to know what gold is. If you don't know what gold is, you are just wasting your time. Because you'll be given a shining stone. All these things we are flicking around in the name of religion all over the world. There is a classification in which all those things are placed under illusion. Man must know himself and his state in the universe. And know what himself is. And know what he's seeking for, what he's not seeking for. But when these things are not known, then darkness and illusions will hold sway. You see. Because before, this woman, she was seen as a prophetess of God in the realm of a great Pentecostal church. That when that name is mentioned, that the name of that Pentecostal church is mentioned, it is believed that members of that Pentecostal church are born again and they are aspiring to go to heaven. I am telling you that even in the midst of such things, when you see such things, whatever name they are called all over the world, when you see place, you say, this is a Pentecostal, we are planning to go to heaven. Don't say because that of it is so. There are no false prophets there. There are still false prophets there. So this woman will come, you know, she will say, when she stands up and wants to speak, sometimes she speaks things that are look general for the whole church. Sometimes she will say something for a person. If he's speaking and come to you as a person, you're a man kneeling down. If your name is Okonkwo, you say Okonkwo, Okonkwo, Okonkwo. He gives you a slap on your toa. In short, the belief of that moment is that this slap is a chastisement from the Lord.
that did really believe. At any time, Duma used to slap many of them. Even though she's just a prophetess in the church, when she under that influence, under that kind of manipulation, if you like be a Jehovah's Witness, I can give you, I can maim you, because it is believed that that one is done by the Lord now. So Duma used that thing. People, and when he slapped that person, he would came, he may call himself fornicator. Now, all this is continuing in the church. And truth, the man will know that himself is a fornicator, because the woman will tell him, say, on the third of so and so day, on so and so day, so and so time, you went to this hotel to fornicate or to commit adultery. The Lord is chastising you now. Oh my God, you blow her again. Everybody. So this is, because this thing continues to happen in the church. It has become a norm, a process. Not knowing that the woman has a high network. That if, for instance, if so and so deacon is programmed to be monitored, some boss will monitor the deacon. If they monitor you for 3 months, they see that you are not, if you are a kind of a deacon that used to hide and go and drink beer, the boys will find you out. Because the boys will also set up another boys. Those boys set up another boys. They are monitoring, they monitor you. If even the hotel you're in, that they will know. The girl will follow, they will know. So when they gather this information, the business of those boys were just to gather information and bring to the woman. That's her network. And her own should be dishing out this information, because she will tell the man, so and so day, so and so time, you drove so and so vehicle, so and so number. Can you remember? You were with a girl, she was wearing so and so clothes. You took her to a hotel. Give me a slap, fornicator, on her home. Adultery, you see. So now these are the things going on. But brothers, my dear viewers, I'm telling you that this thing I'm telling you worked so hard that so many people, it was used to even so many issues were settled. Issue that church hierarchy cannot settle, they bring it to the woman, because they believe he's consulting with the Holy Ghost. The woman used that thing to be in charge. Indirectly, she was not in charge of the church. Until they use that thing now, when that deacon, and when that district pastor spoke about her in the light of, he didn't feel that, because the Lord every Sunday, because sometimes every Sunday when they come to the church, some people go with swollen eyes, because the woman, so the district pastor was wondering, which word of the Lord is it, because sometimes people come to the church. And when they are going home, as part of the chastisement of the Lord, you see, you know, there's a way somebody can hit this your eye. The pain will enter into you. So you see them over there. So the man was wondering. So when the information got to this woman, that they were wondering, that the district pastor is beginning to question her capabilities, the woman came from another center and rose up. Move around, and announced that Jehovah God has removed the district pastor. And has elevated the other one. That was how they, a lot of, that this, the district pastor was sent on suspension. Because the church, the that organization, that structure, we can't oppose what that woman said. The woman used that until the boys in that church now confessed. You see? They now confessed to the truth of how they've been serving at the network of this woman. It was when that woman was disarmed, finally revealed as a false prophet in the midst, disarmed and taken away, that the church began to stand upon the platform of goodness. By the Spirit of God embedded in that true servant of God, the district pastor. But before then, falsehood reigned. You don't know that this falsehood is reigning in different places. I say, if you are searching for gold, know what gold is. Otherwise, someone is going to give you a shining stone, and you will take it. I keep on saying this. So, don't allow yourself to be bothered by be carried away by all these things. Don't live in fear. Don't live in fear, because fear is part of the basis of this manipulation. Fear is very, very important to this manipulation. And let me tell you again. You may say, oh, a church, that was a church, a Pentecostal church, founded by a bishop. And in all sincerity, that bishop is a lovely servant of God, a humble man, Everybody knew that this man is you know, making all effort to live in the light of God. And that the man, though the Lord bless him, he has some money and so on, but one pastor, one poor pastor came to marry his daughter. And when this pastor came to marry his daughter, he said, well, okay. As far as you say that it is the will of God, my daughter, do you love this man? I said, yes. The man did not put financial or material opulence into consideration. He followed the scriptures and gave that his daughter out and told the man to come and bring his people to come and marry the daughter. The wife of that bishop, now this is the wife of the bishop, and she's the mother, the so-called spiritual mother of the church. And no one knew that she is the first prophet there. You see, a bishop may come out, a man of God come out and say, Jesus Christ said two shall sleep on one bed. One will be taken, another one will be left behind. So when you say, don't quote the name of your church, which church are you? You quote the name of your church, then you become gratified that by the name of the church, I'm going to meet God. That's nothing like that. It's an individual race. And I'm talking to you individually. I'm not talking to an organization. I'm talking to you as a person, that you listen to this. Because anywhere, any organization you belong to in this world, be very careful, because false prophets are there. Beware of the false prophet. You can hardly see any organization in this world now. The organization of, you say you have 10,000 people, and all the 10,000 people are total saints. It's possible, but it's difficult, but it is not impossible. Because I am not the Lord. The Lord knows the best, but I am warning you. You should understand the scriptures and follow the scriptures, and at the same time understand that falsehood exists in different places. This woman, the wife of the bishop, didn't want her daughter, to marry what is classified as a poor man, and the woman knew that her husband is a man of God, and that as he has given his word, he will not change. He will not consider materiality. That man of God does not consider money. Say, because he's poor. No. He only considers the fact that this pastor is a godly man. So, but the woman now pretended openly. You see, that is what Jesus Christ said, that these false prophets, they appear in sheep's clothing, but inwardly, they are even inward. In that sheep's clothing, she gave her consent, you know, do everything, was even planning for the marriage. Calling the man on the phone, do everything in a way the man, nobody will suspect. She now asked the man to come and see him, to see her. And that this you're coming to see me is between me and you as your mother-in-law. Let us leave the bishop alone. Just come privately to see me. They arrange how to receive this and say, have something to discuss with her. Meanwhile, this same woman planted some people. Some of them were deacons in the church, to kill that pastor. When the pastor came, they abducted the pastor and killed the pastor and buried him. What is that? Is that not one of the highest activities of false prophet? To commit murder? Huh? Then when the man was killed, even this so-called wife of a bishop, she was also the one that when she heard that the man was missing, everybody searching, her daughter crying and lamenting, she brought her money to assist in any area of investigation. She was the perpetrator, and she was the one sponsoring investigation to find out the perpetrators. This happened in Nigeria. Those of you in Nigeria, listen to me. Some of you know about this. I don't want to mention, because the matter eventually got to the police and everything. The woman herself, she has already reaped what she sowed. Because after some time, one of the deacons, the spirit of the Lord went and tormented that deacon until the deacon came out and confessed. It was an open confession. The deacon said, look, we are the one. Our mama said we should confess. They went to where they buried the man in the forest and saw the grave and dug out the body. That activity took place in a Pentecostal church. It took place in the enclave where there's even a genuine man of God as the bishop of the church, where the wife was the first prophet. So sometimes when you hear false prophet, you begin to look at organization. In every organization you see good people there. Pray God to lead you on the path of goodness, so that goodness will attract good and you will experience good in your life. False prophets are everywhere. I'm warning you in this world. Everywhere they are now. Huh? They're in different places.
The false prophets are everywhere. They are in different places. Pray the light of the Almighty Father to lead you so that you will not fall into their anger. I pray for the viewer of this message. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that the light of heaven will guide you so that you will be on the path of those that are set forth to deliver others from the enclave of the occult maladies and false prophets. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.